21st, the regular meeting on November 28th, the committee of the whole meeting on December 5th, the adjourned meeting on November 28th and December 12th, the regular meeting on December 12th, and the committee of the whole meeting on December 19th.
Support.
We have a motion by Councilman Kakowski, supported by Councilman Frazier. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion is carried. Next, we come to the consent agenda. Councilman, the items that you wish to...
Madam Chair, item, consent agenda, item number C, letter number C is one that I have one question on.
Well, hold on, item number C.
And then just clarification on the consent agenda item E. It is certainly mentioned that where we, as opposed to...
Oh, well, we'll get to that when we move down to the end.
No, I think if you want to just leave that on and just pull the consent agenda,
Please? Hopefully.
The clarification on...
We can do that when we get that one.
Okay.
I have a question on D.
Do you have a question on one question?
Yeah.
Michael Cohen C, we'll call him D. And Michael Cohen E. All right, consent agenda item A and E. Have a motion? Why do you need to consider the items C and... Consent agenda item A is an award of a bid for water and sewer infrastructure maintenance to Liquid Force Services, USA, Lodge, Michigan, and the non-exceed annual amount of $1.7 million. Funds are approved for the purpose of the 2011-2012 water and sewer budget and will be requested in subsequent year budgets as council may approve. Service provided includes water main and sewer cleaning along with structural repairs and relining. The city's water and sewer system encompasses some 600 miles of water and sewer main. These services extend the useful life of the city's water and sewer system at a much lower cost and with minimal disruption to homeowners, businesses, and the motoring public when compared to conventional, more invasive, total reconstruction. The recommended contract award is for a 3-year period with an option to renew for 2 additional 1-year periods. The contractor has previously completed water main and sewer reconstruction for the city of Southfield and has performed similar projects in other jurisdictions such as Bloomfield Township and the cities of Berkeley, Lincolnburg, and Southgate. Aggregate unit prices have been held flat from the previous contract. Item C is award of bid for road care and maintenance materials along with debris removal and hauling services to Ellsworth Industries of Plymouth, Michigan in the not to exceed annual amount of $283,805, $127,935 for materials, and $155,874 for debris hauling services. The term of the contract is 1 year beginning March 1st, 2012. With the option to extend for an additional 1 year, funds are provided in the 2011-2012 Streets and Highways and Parks and Recreation budgets and will be requested in future budgets as council may approve. Per ton costs for these purposes are flat compared to past history. Item C is a water bid for tree trimming and removal services to three companies to provide natural flexibility for addressing various needs of the city and to provide sufficient capacity in case of emergency or storm conditions. These contracts are for a 1 year period with 2 1-year renewal options and a combined not to exceed annual cost of $260,000. Funds are provided in the 2011-2012 forestry budget and in the Dangerous Tree Removal Loan Program and will be requested in future budgets as council may approve. The recommended contractors are the Michigan Property Network, located in Highland, Michigan, Owens Tree Service, located in Auburn Hills, Michigan, and Shock Brothers Tree Care, located in Warren, Michigan. Item B is awarded bid to HP Products of Belleville, Michigan, to provide paper, handhelds, and tissue products for the 33 buildings that are the responsibility of the facilities maintenance department. This award is for a 1-year council may approve. Item E is the award of contract for fuel hauling and delivery services to three bidders, Petroleum Traders of Fort Wayne, Indiana, for unleaded regular, and RKA Petroleum of Romulus, Michigan, for ULS number 2 diesel fuel delivered by truck transport for large requirements. And Atlas Oil of Romulus, Michigan, for both unleaded regular and ULS number 2 diesel delivered by tank wagon for smaller deliveries to various city locations not within the municipal complex or the DPW facility. The recommended contract period is 2 years with an option to extend for an additional 2 years. Funds are provided for this purpose in the 2011-2012 Public Works and Parks and Recreation budget and will be requested in future budgets as council may approve. Now,
quantities and the number of cities involved, because what we're looking and the complexity of the equipment, et cetera, but we have expertise that could, that can go to that question.
Thank you. Yeah, in terms of Shaw Brothers, they're just going to be basically the standby, and they would be ran at an hourly. They wouldn't be ran at their DBH pricing. The first two are going to be the primary contractors. We need three to submit bids for the hazard tree ordinance through the code enforcement department. So that's why we have three contractors. That was the only reason why we asked for that third one.
So the hourly rate, let's say a resident would need a tree trimmed or removed, the hourly rate by Shaw Brothers would still be less than $66 or
This is not for driving use. This is only for trees within the right of way or any dangerous tree that could be out there that code enforcement would deem us have to take down.
Well, helping out there. I thought it said that we could use them for residents as well if needed. Residential.
If they apply for the hazard tree loan, if they have a hazardous tree situation and they need to apply for our hazard tree loan program, that's where we would utilize three contractors. That enables three contractors to submit bids to the homeowner. The homeowner then brings it back to code enforcement and they evaluate to which one is the best pricing. And they don't have to stay with that pricing. They can afford better pricing, and they usually do because it's competitive.
So they're not limited to these three contractors?
Correct. Well, no. On the hazard tree loan program, yes.
They are.
Just about a resident that wants their tree trimmed,
right,
say on your street.
Right.
It's not a dangerous tree. It's just a normal tree in the on their property. That amount right there does not go back to the resident. They can't use our tree. I mean, they can use them, but they might not get the same pricing.
Would it be higher or?
It's whatever it is, you know.
Today.
Right. That is only, like I said, those are for trees that are in the right of way that need to be trimmed, need to be taken down, storm damage that's in the right of way, or if there's a tree deemed dangerous by the city forester or code enforcement.
But a resident can use any tree company to cut
sure.
the tree.
As long as they're licensed.
As long as they're licensed and don't use the funds that are paid for.
Correct.
Yes. Okay.
Okay.
Yes, consent agenda item D, the award went to H.P. Pratt of Belleville. My question is this an all or nothing? Because the second bidder, APAC paper from Allen Park, a $33,000 bid, they're only $1.50 difference. I mean, that's cutting pretty thin.
Very. We had that discussion as well. Ms. Townsell, if you could come up and help us with that. In terms of the award of the bid, they get the bid, but that doesn't mean that we can't go to other suppliers.
Good evening. Through the chair to Councilwoman Kristen Frazier. At this point, it is an all or nothing bid. We're trying to simplify the ordering and delivery process. However, you're absolutely right. The prices were extremely close this year. Should something happen and, you know, we need to order from a different supplier under $10,000, obviously we could utilize APAC paper. But that wasn't what we were looking to do. Right?
Through the chair, what we can do, because it is very close, is we can look at the offerings of the second company, and if there are products that are lower in price, we can consider using them for giving them some of the business. But it's difficult, no matter how close it is. I mean, if you're going to have a bid, it's just the way it comes out.
Right. We've actually already done that. There's four items under contract, and the prices were
do what we can for a bidder that's that close, so.
Well, I thought maybe there was some reason that if it was an all or nothing, that there were some economies of scale that if we split it between the two, that it would really cost us more than if we.
In working with the facilities maintenance department in terms of ordering and keeping track of who's supposed to get which product from which company, we decided to keep it.
Okay, cool. Yeah, it's been more than $1.50, so. Okay, thanks.
I also would like to bring to council's attention, as well as our viewers and folks in the audience, the total cost is a 13% decrease in the previous contract, so it's extremely competitive.
Madam Chair, I would move to consent agenda C, D, and E.
Support.
Motion by Mr. Seiler, supported by Mr. Jordan, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, motion has carried.
Thank you, council.
Now we're going back to the presentation and the mayor.
Good evening to council and to the viewing audience. It's an honor today for me to be able to recognize one of our business owners and leaders in our community tonight. I have had the pleasure of knowing this wonderful man for a number of years. Mr. Booth McNair, would you mind joining me at the podium? He is the owner, president of the Southfield Star and Lincoln dealership. During the time that I have known him, I have witnessed his hard work ethic and your dedication to the city. His dealership was built in 1970 and was one of the select group of dealers from across the country to be honored this year in the National Automobile Association Convention in Las Vegas. Today, he owns 6 dealerships with his 2 sons and 2 grandsons are also part of the business. So it gives me great honor to join in this recognition of you, who wears the Time Dealer of the Year Award, one of the automobile industry's most prestigious and highly coveted honors. Recipients are among the nation's most successful auto dealers, who must also demonstrate a long-standing commitment to community service. Mr. McNair, your support in a wide range of organizations as a donor to religious, educational, sports, and health services and community services. Star Lincoln was built by Hood in 1970 on a foundation of performance, customer treatment, and customer satisfaction. Now, therefore, be it resolved that I, the mayor of the city of Southfield and of Oakland County, state of Michigan, do hereby recognize Hoot McNair as the recipient of the Time Dealer of the Year Award, and be it further resolved that the citizens of Southfield congratulate you for your dedication and to the automobile industry and for your years of service to this community. I'm honored to present this to you and say thank you for everything.
I thought they were going to be a refund of my taxes. Well, I got you all here, but say you've got a fine city, and I've done very well here. That city started from nothing, or number one, we can think of it in your whole country. So there's some good areas to do business with. I got to tell you how much complaints I've got against you. It took us a half hour to find your city hall. But the city is a good city. I just read about it in the paper. I never had the assistant get over to the police department yet. I don't know what that said. But I would say something. You ought to be proud of your city, as I am. I don't live in the area. I live up in Bloomfield. But I want to tell you something. Here, wants to do some business in here. This is a place to live. Thank you very much.
Yay. off the public hearing and other matters. I'd also like to point out that the city attorney has informed me that any action that disturbs the council meeting can be considered a violation of state law and city ordinance, and a person who causes a disturbance can be required to leave the meeting. So I'd like to just sum up by simply saying that council and mayor would appreciate everyone using common courtesy tonight and allowing our meeting to be held in a business like manner. And while I didn't say at the beginning of the meeting, if you have a cell phone, please turn it off. I would ask that you do that or turn down the silent feature. And also, if anyone has something to say that involves a staff member of our city, an issue that you might have had with the department, we would appreciate it if you would not use the name of the individual, but address the issue with regard to the department as opposed to individual staff person. Mr. Crowe?
Good evening. For the chair, our first special use public hearing is GP 1230. Which is a special use request of Mona Hamel Mood from Iconic Design on behalf of the owner, Dr. Petrie, to locate a 335-square-foot pharmacy inside the medical office building located at 25130 Southfield Road. On the east side of Southfield Road between Jeanette Street and Sherwood Circle in Section 24 of the city. The subject property, as well as the property to the west across Southfield Road, is zoned OS, office service. The property to the north across Jeanette is zoned RM, multiple family low rise. The properties to the east are zoned R2, single family residential. The properties to the south across Sherwood Circle are zoned B3, general business, and P, vehicular parking. With regard to the existing land uses, the subject property contains a vacant office building. The property to the north across Jeanette is developed with the Lee Chateau condominiums. The property to the west across Southfield Road is developed with the Coastal and Federal Family Credit Union. The properties to the south across Sherwood Circle are developed with the retail center and a parking lot. The properties to the east are developed with single-family housing fronting on Jeanette and the Chateau Villa condominiums. The site contains 1.1 acres of land. There is 238 feet of frontage on Southfield Road with a depth of 207 feet. The special use request is to permit a pharmacy within a medical office in the OS, Office Service Zoning District. Issues considered by the Planning Department during the review of the special use were: one, the special use general standards and conditions of the OS, Office Service District. Two, proposal is in accordance with the Southfield Comprehensive Master Plan, noting local mixed use for this parcel. And three, the petitioner is to implement the recommendations made by the Southfield Police Department Crime Prevention Bureau regarding site security. The Planning Department received the special use request on June 28, 2011. The Planning Commission held a public hearing on these matters on October 26, 2011, and made a favorable recommendation. Tonight we have Ms. Mona Hamoud from Iconic Design to make a brief presentation, and we'll turn it over to you for public hearing, and we'll be available to answer any questions that the council may have.
So does the petitioner wish to come forward?
Good evening. My name is Mona Hamoud. I live in Dearborn. I'm here representing Dr. Petre.
I'm sorry, Ms. Hamoud, we need your address for the...
It's 17 West Lane Court in Dearborn, 48124. I'm here on behalf of Dr. Petre. He's using an entire building as the offices, medical offices. So he has one floor for administration offices, for doctor's offices.
Could you put the microphone up a little bit so we're more difficult for you?
Okay.
Thank you.
And the first level is going to be clinic and emergency clinic. So we're only asking for about 300 square feet for a pharmacy on the first level. It's going to be in the back of the building. It's not visible from the street. And it's going to be something that's going to complement the use of the entire building.
Okay. All right.
It's basically for the use of the people who come to the clinic on their way out.
council may have questions, but first of all, I want to open the public hearing.
Okay.
So if you would like to sit down. Declare the public hearing open. If there's anyone who would like to come forward to address this issue, please do so. Seeing none, I'm declaring the public hearing closed.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Kotowski.
Sorry, I didn't get the young lady's name. I couldn't hear it, but she's representing the doctor who owns the facility. Is that correct?
Correct.
Could you tell me what the hours of operation of the pharmacy would be?
They are determined from around 7 o'clock in the morning to 7 at night. And we are securing the parking. And we're working with the fire department and the police department regarding that.
The office hours are in the building are the same?
Yes, the same.
Will that, from 7 to 7, will you have a registered pharmacist on duty?
I'm sorry?
Will you have a registered pharmacist on duty?
Yes, yes. We're already talking to somebody who's interested.
You will only install pharmaceuticals?
Yeah.
Or other items?
Just pharmaceutical, as far as I know.
Thank you. I was just asking the question, Council, because I just wondered, we have three pharmacies on tonight, relocated in medical buildings, and I know there's one that was just put in at 12 Mile in Southfield at Lake the Village. I'm just wondering why the periphery of small pharmaceutical facilities are in these buildings when most, like the Rouge Drugstore went out because they were small and there was the other pharmacy, I know that Mr. Lance went to George's up there on 12 Mile Road in Evergreen. He couldn't make it either. And he's been there for many years. He's now at CVS. I'm just wondering what's happening that we have so many at one time in this last year or before in the same vicinity.
Through the chair, Mr. Percassi. We're seeing this as a new business model for medical office buildings. This is a way to for the doctors to generate additional income and also to provide a convenience specifically to their patients. And this is trend is happening not just in Southfield but all over the metro area.
It was stated, Mr. Curry, it was stated that this pharmacy would be in the rear of the building. Is that correct?
Through the chair, this is a floor plan, and the area that's highlighted in yellow shows a specific location on the floor plan.
That's
so it's located on the west side of the floor plan, or the rear of the building.
Yeah.
So it's not, it's, there's no drive through.
It's upside down, is it?
Yeah.
No.
No.
Okay. It doesn't matter. It's the rear of the building, though.
Yeah, that's correct.
And, well, then someone who would like to get a prescription be able to go to that facility and have their prescription filled?
My understanding is, and from the ones I'm familiar with, the doctor's office, as the patient is leaving their office visit, the prescription is sent over electronically, and it's available for them shortly as they walk out the door. That's the new business model.
In other words, that would be the only clients that would, customers that pharmacy would have?
I've been...
Those in the building?
99% of their business is anticipated to be from doctors within the building itself.
Why do we ever want to regulate businesses? But I'm just finding this very difficult to understand how these small, little, tiny pharmacies are going to make it when they're not encouraging outside prescriptions to be filled and just depending on when the tenants and whoever patients are in that building. The building isn't that big. And when we have three, and there's one, I said, in the village that was just put in, it seems like, I guess we can figure out in retail how they can make it. But anyway, that's their prerogative, and I will go along with it, I guess.
Can I just add a comment? I've seen the pharmacy, disciples that use the pharmacy in many offices, small doctor's offices. Sometimes you only have one or two doctors practicing, and then you just have a window to just pick up the prescription on the way out. So it's kind of practical for people to use. I've
pockets have not been successful. If you're going to depend upon you to take the doctor, patients from the doctors, you're not going to do any volume or make any money. You're going to have to advertise for the outsiders to come in and bring their prescriptions into you also.
Dr. Fetcher was supposed to be here tonight to answer questions. I don't know, I don't have all the answers to these questions. But to my understanding, it's going to be full most of the time for just the people who come into the building. That doesn't mean that outside people are not allowed to come in and have a prescription there. But I'm just a designer here for the plan. I just don't see, what if it fails? It's only 300 square feet, so he can replace it. If it doesn't work as a business, he can replace it eventually to be an office, part of his office building.
Thank you. I also noticed that it's proposed to be a sleep clinic, if that's what's correct in the document.
Originally, that's the original plan, but I did talk to the doctor and asked about this. He said he might end up not having that.
Okay, because I know that in certain sleep clinics, you could have patients up there, you know, for hours under tests or whatever. So I think it's a matter of also convenience, particularly to a sleep clinic. You know, if you've been there for quite a while throughout the day, getting tests and studies done. I've had friends that have sleep issues and have been in sleep clinics under study. You could be there for a while. So a matter of convenience, to, if you've been there for a while, just want to pick up your prescription and go, makes more sense specifically to a sleep clinic.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Mr.
I wanted to comment that this is not a new concept. 40 years ago, I was a patient of Dr. Lloyd Paul, and he and his colleagues ran a little drugstore as part of their medical office. I know that when I was his patient, I would use the pharmacy because it was right on the way out to the car. It was very convenient, and I didn't have to go someplace else. So I see an advantage to this. It's not new by coincidence tonight. We got two of the same request. And I always feel that it's not our job to regulate the competition. You'll do that through your pricing and the customers you attract. I also want to say that I am really pleased that we have this development happening of the medical offices in this building. It's been rather forlorn for some time, and the landscaping has needed some improvement. And so I'm glad to see the building is going to be occupied and have new life.
Thank you.
So, welcome.
Thank you. Operation?
Yeah, I know we're not approving the site plan, but I'm a little confused about the site plan. The print that I got had a yellow outline that showed pharmacy waiting room. Is that where that is on that one?
Yes.
I don't understand. Where's the pharmacy? I mean, you don't mix the waiting room and the drugs all in the same room.
There's a counter that's labeled where the pharmacy is.
Which part is the pharmacy?
Right here.
Okay.
Right adjacent to the waiting room.
Well, the print that I get to have, it just shows, yeah, but this is all waiting room and pharmacy. There's
perhaps,
and the counter shows the other side of the waiting room.
Right. I believe the area was just designated as where the public is coming in to the pharmacy. Think of it. It's just the way it was outlined.
Okay.
The total square footage is 300.
Oh, they do something to barricade the drug from the...
Yeah, there's a wall and a counter that separates the pharmacy itself from the waiting area where the patients pick up their prescriptions.
Okay, that's good to me. I'll talk to you.
Thank you.
Mr. Sanders, supported by Mr. Frazier, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Motion has carried. I'd just like to add that I have seen this type of operation in office buildings and medical office buildings, and where there is an opportunity to pick up prescriptions right there for certain types of things. So it's not really, it might be new to us, but it's not really new in the industry. The next public hearing is GC 1231. Mr. Close?
Through the chair, as you stated, the next item is GP 1231. A special use review request of Design Inc. on behalf of the owner Sundance Inc. to prevent a non-industrial use or use not specifically related to manufacturing in the I-1 Industrial Zoning District. This request is made to facilitate the proposed construction of a new 1987 gross square foot Taco Bell restaurant located at 24024 West Nine Mile Road on the northwest corner of West Nine Mile Road and Telegraph Road. The existing Taco Bell is going to be torn down and a brand new one is going to be built. The existing building square footage is 1,976. The new building square footage will just add two additional square feet for a total of 1,978 square feet. The existing building currently seats 45 patrons. The new building will seat 42 patrons. So just a slightly smaller seating area. The Planning Department received a special use request on September 15, 2011. The Planning Commission held a public hearing on these matters on December 14, 2011 and made a favorable recommendation. I have a small, brief video to show the council at this time.
Regarding site security.
representative of Taco Bell here tonight to make a brief presentation, and he'll be available to answer any questions that the council may have.
Good evening. My name is James Barnwell with Design Incorporated, 2183 Cross Drive, Lake Michigan. The presentation planner was pretty thorough. The owner of Sundance Incorporated is looking at this property and the building. It's been there for 30 years. There's been improvements in the operations and the equipment that's available to him. And also an overriding issue is that the new corporate standards and image that they're trying to project at Taco Bell is away from the old mission style and the stucco buildings and present a little more upscale drive-through restaurant. So what we're proposing is basically demoing the existing building in its entirety and reconstructing it to the new standards. Is there any questions?
I declare the public hearing open. Is there anyone who wishes to speak to this issue?
Pamela Gerald, P.O. Box 155, Southfield, Michigan, 48037-0155. My telephone number is 248-352-9188. I just have a couple of questions. Mr. Terry Crowe mentioned that there was a public hearing, I think you said, on December the 15th. There was no council meeting on December the 15th. If my memory serves me correct, the council meeting was December 5th, December 12th, and maybe the 19th. So could you state officially on the record when the public hearing was, because I don't remember this public hearing. And then also, too, previously council talked about the access, say, turning in if you're coming south on Telegraph into the parking lot, and then being able to exit out on 9 Mile, and they talked about that very thing as it related to a couple of gas stations in the city of Southfield. I want to know, increasing the square footage, is that going to pose a problem? Being able to enter one way and also enter the other way, turning if you're coming down 9 Mile Road headed west. Is it going to pose a problem turning in right with people trying to exit out of that same parking lot, since we've talked about it before? And this is just something that I've heard you guys talk about when it was a restaurant. I hope that Taco Bell will explore the option of improving the quality of beef that they use and not use the industry standard to go along with your beautiful new corporate image that you are trying to display. And that's all.
Would you like to answer any of the questions about the entrance and exit?
Just to clarify, I had stated that a public hearing was held on December 14th. That was a public hearing that was held by the Planning Commission, not the City Council. The overall square footage increase is 2 square feet, but a reduction of 2 seats. And the new layout takes into account turning radiuses and traffic going southbound on Telegraph and westbound on 9 Mile. It's a much better flow. We took several times reviewing the various drive-through locations, and probably went through about 4 or 5 different iterations of the site plan to come up with something that the traffic engineering in the city could live with.
So it has been reviewed by the traffic engineer and has been given their stamp of approval.
That's correct.
Thank you. If there's no anyone else who wants to speak at the public hearing, declare the public hearing closed. Mr. Price?
Available if there's any questions from the council.
I do have Mr. Lance had a and I guess those questions been answered as well. Mr. Frazier?
It wasn't real clear on the prints that I have, but I think that I haven't figured out. The ordering place is that on the southwest corner of the building?
That's correct.
It is what's
five or off.
Okay. Also, there's only one
free out of 25 is a van accessible, barrier-free parking space. And then it increases depending on the total number of parking spaces that are part of the lot.
Okay. Also, is there a door on the east side of the building? Because you have the angle parking on the east side of the building. No, that's the west side. Way up above.
Can you orientate telegraph on this photo?
Thank you. through the chair. Our next item is GP 1232, special use request of Cadilla Pharmacy on behalf of the owner, Dr. Gupta, to permit a pharmacy and prescription center when located in or near medical offices, medical clinics, hospitals, convalescent or nursing homes, or similar facilities in the OS Office Service Zoning District. This request is made to facilitate the operation of a 1,283 square foot pharmacy within the existing medical office building located at 23832 Southfield Road. Planning Department received a special use request on November 9th, 2011. The Planning Commission held a public hearing on these matters on December 14th, 2011 and made a favorable recommendation. I'd like to present a brief video to the council. Have the pharmacist here tonight to make a brief presentation, and we'll be available to answer questions after the public hearing has been conducted.
Did you wish to say anything before we open the public hearing? Did you wish to say anything before we open the public hearing?
No, I don't.
Nothing? All right. Then I declare the public hearing open. If there's anyone that wishes to address this issue. Would you please give your name and address for the record?
Madam Chairman, my name is Gerard Mullen. Since 1968, I lived at 17880 Louis Street, 165 feet south of the petitioner. I wish to lodge three legal challenges to this public hearing. As you will see, any one of these three challenges precludes this council from conducting business on number one, is due to the failure of Southfield City Council.
Excuse me, sir, we can't hear you, could you?
Come on, okay.
Maybe try to pull that up a little bit closer to that might help. It will pull up.
Okay, hear me now?
That's good.
Okay, let me start over again. Legal challenge number one is due to the failure of the Southfield City Council to publish a proper legal notice regarding this petition. Council erroneously cites as its controlling authority for this public hearing Article 18, Section 5.169, the General Business District, Section B3. In actuality, the petitioner's site is located in an OS service district. The correct citation that council should have referred to but failed to was Article 9, Section 5.104, the Office Service District section. Therefore, council is not empowered tonight to act on this petition. Parenthetically, I'd like to point out to council that this error is the rule, not the exception. Every legal notice that council has published in the last 6 months, without exception, contains at least one error. For example, let's take tonight's agenda. Council erroneously cites the wrong control authority in every legal notice for all four of tonight's petitions. GP 1230 should be Article 9, Section 5.104. GP 1231 should be Article 20, Section 5.185. GP 1232 should be Article 9, Section 5.104. GP 1233 should be Article 20, Section 5.185. Legal challenge number two is due to the failure of the Southfield Planning Commission to publish a proper legal notice regarding this petition. The commission's legal notice was published illegally 2 days outside the prescribed statutory time limit as mandated by Chapter 45, Article 4, Section 5.22-1. Hence, the commission recommendation to council has no legal standing at this public hearing. Therefore, council cannot act on this petition tonight. Parenthetically, I'd like to point out to council, this error is the rule, not the exception. Every legal notice that the commission has published in the last 3 years, without exception, contains this error, that is published illegally outside the prescribed statutory time limit. And finally, legal challenge number three is due to the unlawful behavior of the Southfield Planning Department in not allowing me to inspect the public file for this evening's public hearing. On December 2nd, 2011, I asked both the building and planning departments if I could inspect their respective public file regarding the petitioner. Both departments denied my request, and both departments said I needed to file a Freedom of Information request, a FOIA, with the city clerk's office in order to inspect these files. On January 13, 2012, I submitted a FOIA request regarding both files. It was rejected. The city clerk told me no FOIA was needed to inspect either file. Then she called on my behalf to the building department and obtained the information that I had sought regarding the building department's file, and she wrote it on the back of my FOIA request. Yet to this very day, I am still denied access to the planning department's public file regarding this petition. It is a sad day for democracy when I, John Q. Public, can inspect the public file for this evening's public hearing. Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thank you.
Mr. Crow, do you have any comments? Do you have any comments that you'd like to make? And I'd like to address the city attorney also on the issue.
I'll try to do some in reverse order. It's our policy that we do not allow the public to review any site plan files unless they follow the procedures of requesting a FOIA in the proper manner. So I am not aware that that the FOIA was received in time for review for tonight's meeting. attorney's office before we make that available to the public. We're required through public trust to ensure that there's no damage to the files and that they're properly recorded and paper trail is established before reviewing it to the public. I believe the public, the building department's following the same policy.
Ms. Ward, I think we need you to weigh in on this.
Well, I'm not aware that a FOIA request was submitted. Nothing has come through our office indicating that somebody has wanted to review those records. So typically they would be, they would go to the FOIA coordinator, Mr. St. Clair, and then there would be some indication to our office that there was a FOIA, and we would review it for purposes of whether there were any exemptions that would apply. I'm not seeing one.
Well, the big issue is, one of the issues is the date of the way they were, the way it was published, the date and the references, and that's...
Yeah, okay. I thought we were talking about the FOIA, because Mr. Crowe hadn't gone through that analysis yet.
The second item is that we're required to have it published 15 days prior to the meeting, and as far as I'm aware, that we've met that statutory requirement. So if we haven't, I'd have to investigate. But our procedure is 15 days prior to the meeting, it has to be published. And we trigger all of our submittals to the paper in accordance with that 15-day rule requirement. So I'm not aware of us violating that.
The ordinance would require 15 days, so not a special use of rule. Planning Commission.
Okay,
in December. December. The notice in terms of the public hearing tonight does say not less than 5 days, not more than 15 days, but you're talking about a notice from the planning commission.
It's the identical stipulation for planning.
It does say the same thing, but without the notice in front of us to see what the dates are, I
right got it.
I don't have it.
Can I hand it to you? I mean,
you try. No, you go ahead. You can enter. What are you doing? Are you more difficult?
Sir, no, we're not trying to make things difficult. We're trying to clarify what you're saying. No, this is a minute. We're trying to clarify what you're saying, and we're trying to act properly up here. So we have to get some legal advice. And whoever may be in the clerk, we try to put this all together so we can act properly tonight and not be illegal. So just relax and let's go through our process of trying to figure out what we have to do to either act on this or not. Okay?
By this document, it would indicate that the public hearing from the Planning Commission was held or was scheduled to be held on December 14th, and it was published November 27th. That would be 17 days, more than 15. So that would be an issue with the notice requirement that's set forth in the ordinance.
For the chair.
But how does that affect what we're doing tonight?
Well,
does that make what we're doing illegal?
If it was not properly noticed in front of the Planning Commission, I think it should have been properly noticed in front of the Planning Commission. Correct.
For the chair.
Mr. Cronin.
We believe we follow proper procedure. I would like an opportunity to review the state statute. I believe the confusion here is that the zoning ordinance language with regards to publication may not have been updated to be consistent with the state statute. I believe we are following the state statute, which now states minimum of 15 days. I can't answer that question tonight. But I'm confident that we've followed the proper procedures with regards to public hearing notices.
I think to the chair, if the matter was simply postponed tonight, we'll take a look at the notices when they were published, we'll look at everything, and we will come back with a recommendation as to whether we need to renotice it or we're in compliance.
Well, that's what I've been trying to say, and couldn't get the floor.
Well, that's what we're trying to do.
Mr. Mullen also mentioned that there seems to be some nomenclature errors.
Yes, I know he did.
The numbers, I don't know if it's where you're getting the code from. Is it the website? From the website?
Oh, no. You're published. This is what you published.
Okay, you have a hard copy.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I believe you. I know sometimes there's just been a discrepancy between what's on the website and what's in the article.
I'm not talking about the website. I'm saying you're 4-for-4 tonight.
Yes.
Every petition tonight is an error. You cited the wrong control authority. Every notice for the last 6 months that you've generated is an error.
Okay.
That's what I'm telling you. There's an error in every one of them.
Well, we need to clear that up, obviously. I have another suggestion as well. I don't know why we continue to place this notice in the eccentric when we have paper that goes to every single home in Southfield. If we really wanted to notify our community, I would suggest that we use the Southfield fund, which goes to every home, so that we do have broader notification to the public.
Madam Chair, Mr. Seidler, at the beginning of each year, the council should have to make what our legal notices and where they should be. So,
we
haven't
done it.
No, we haven't really done that.
And Mr. Blanton, for.
Okay. What I see here is something that's all mixed up. I don't know whether the planning department or the clerk, I don't know. I would suggest we postpone it, and I want to be sure to examine the records, if it goes to legal, to straighten it out, and we can't make a decision tonight.
May I make a decision? position here, because here's the real problem. It's on the foyer. I could walk in 10 years ago in the building department and get any piece of information I wanted. In fact, they were more than helpful.
That's changed. We have no people here.
No people? Change. Well, that doesn't have an excuse.
I know it.
Now, those people should be informed, because I've been given nothing but problems, and I'm working on this for 2 months.
We have everybody taking over power, or so many different powers. That's the problem with this city now. I make a motion to postpone it until we can get to the bottom of this, turn it over to the legal department, or the correct legal advice, and I'd like to see paperwork, too.
Ms. Ward, what would be the proper time to support this to us? If they certainly you could put it to the next regular, we would have an answer by that.
Regular meeting, can we do that?
Okay, Ward.
All right, Mr. Steiner's motion.
Goes to the city clerk and then it's processed from there.
going to have to redo our process.
Yeah, I never knew there are sent certain type of information sent from the public. So we're a transparent city, we're supposed to be.
Well, for example, there are law enforcement investigations.
Well, I'm not talking about law enforcement.
But there's still that both the type of exemptions that are there in the law. And that is the analysis that is undertaken, that if items are exempt under the law, as the legislature has determined in terms of the specific exemption, then those items are not released. That is the process.
That includes zoning and all that?
There may or may not be any exemptions with respect to a zoning file. But there's at least an opportunity for us.
Let's find out.
A staff person to go through and get the file and make sure the documents are there. I mean, it is time consuming.
Well, I just think it behooves us to be as open as possible. I'm very familiar with FOIA law. I understand the exemptions. For instance, the lawsuit, current litigation is exempt. But I don't think we should be fighting or blocking our citizens' access to information, especially Mr. Mullen got an invitation to come to the Planning Commission because he lives within the radius of the site in question.
Well, there must be something wrong here then.
Well, we don't know.
It doesn't make sense to me.
Mr. Chair, to our city attorney, with this particular incident that was related to the FOIA request, are we going to allow, because it seems as if they conflict in information, so at this point, are we going to allow them to have access to the files, or what's going to happen if it's been postponed?
I would certainly, if there hasn't been a written FOIA request made, then has it gone to the city clerk and then there's a response given.
If I could respond, and Mr. Mullen, please correct me. He had a simple question on whether there was any activity going on in the building, a particular location. And he said he was told to come and submit a FOIA request, and he wanted to know if any building permits had been pulled on that particular portion of the building. I, in turn, contacted the building department. And I spoke to the assistant building director and asked if there was any activity. They were familiar with the situation. They, later on that day, contacted him, and I believe the matter was resolved. It was a very simple situation. If you'd like to come up and confirm it. It's not that his FOIA was denied. It was something that could be answered in less than 5 minutes, one telephone call.
Right.
And in this particular situation, why should you put a FOIA in when it was a simple, I made one telephone call, and his question was answered. Mr. Mullen, is that correct?
Yes. Let me show you how silly this is. Because years ago, you walked in, you looked at a file. I'll give you an example. Right next door is the church. So when they had church, it went to the ZBA 6 years ago. I looked at their file. I opened it up, closed it. They're putting in a sign. And I just wanted to be familiar with the sign phone. And they gave me, they Xerox all kinds of stuff for me. And it was very simple. Now I go in December 2nd, and they say no. So I filled out for both. I filled out for both the building and for the planning. It's right here. Both. And Clerk Banks returned it to me. Says you don't need a FOIA file. Just like I said on my presentation. This is the silliness of it. Is I wouldn't be here. I would have gone off of this research where I see you screwed up, excuse the expression, all your legal notices. It's a matter of record if you can't deny it. I mean, they're all wrong. That's pretty embarrassing. And if while I'm at it, you got a lot of grammar problems with your notices. Foot for feet, to lift with a hyphen. It's pretty sad. Look at Latham Village. Libertad Journal is just, it's letter perfect. Letter perfect. City of Southfield has never put out a good notice, period. You should be embarrassed. And I'm somebody that got a C in high school English. See what I'm saying? You look at the notice. This is to win with a hyphen. Find a dictionary that's got a hyphen to win. To win is an adverb. It's not a hyphenated word. It's not a hyphenated word. Foot. You learn in kindergarten, you got 1 foot, 2 feet. Look as you read your notices. Aren't you embarrassed? I mean, here you have the former deputy superintendent of the school system. I guess we don't set a high standard, do we? I would be embarrassed. Every day I look at I get a notice. This goes back years and years and years. I look at notice. I can't believe it. My high school teacher would flunk me. He flunked me. I think he flunked, in my opinion. No attention to detail. All this stuff is done in your name. In your name. Don't you proofread your work? You got four for four. Every notice is four for four. You cited the wrong control authority. Now, ask the city planner. Am I right or am I right? Am I right or am I right?
I'll have to investigate, sir.
There's nothing. It's right there. Rapidly. It's on your hearing notice. I have them.
Mr. Ryan. Madam Chair, as a member of this city for over 43 years, I don't need the legal notices. I have things that come before us, and we assume they are accurate until somebody indicates they aren't.
I mean, somebody.
Yes, but I said, I don't think you should sit there in the middle of the city because we're too great and the city to be too little and talk about our ability to spell and to...
I'm not belittling.
Whatever lines, I think you are. And I don't argue with you, but it could have been a very simple thing for you to walk in and say to the clerk that, this is an error, who's ever checking the thing. I mean, you're a citizen of the city. I mean, it's an obligation of every citizen of the city. If they see something wrong, then say something. And you want to come here and make a scene and embarrass people, if that's what your intention is, it's fine. I'll sit here and listen. But I guess, there's mistakes made. Everybody is human, and I don't know who read the item, but I think it'd be the obligation of somebody who sees something wrong to bring the attention to those who write.
That's why I went to the building department.
But you did come to the clerk, you didn't come to the council, you just are here before us tonight. You could have said very plainly, I wish you would review your legal advertisement because there are things you're wrong with. That'd be so. And we would review it. We do respond to...
Oh, you're going to respond now. You have to.
No, I respond whether you're here or not. A telephone call would be the same.
I brought this up before. Okay, I brought this
You've
up.
Never been before me and brought anything up of this sort, so please don't say something is not true. I've been here 43 years. I don't even think I've met you.
Yes, I have.
Well, I don't remember.
We had a good conversation, 1996. You're mayor. I voted for you. Every time.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Long.
Thank you for the recognition. Had a lot of talking. There were two things that were kind of rolled over that I want to rewind and kind of readdress. Number one was that there's the potential that state law supersedes whatever is in the zoning book anyway. And number two, I want to rewind to what Ms. Ward said, that this meeting that we're in today was properly noticed, correct, or that everything was done correctly. So if we can move forward, I know there was talk of postponing, but an alternate route could be if we move forward with the vote, because I'd get to hear anything specific to the actual meat of the project that is in opposition. If we can move forward and we vote to approve or deny, and Mr. Crowe just simply checks and sees if the state statute trumps what's in our zoning ordinance, we've done nothing wrong. So I we could postpone, and I take your concern seriously. That's why I think there's a quick fix. But we could postpone.
right window. Okay. Southfield decided to approve the window, had to set a higher standard. See, I believe the standard, that a safe statue is probably 20 days out or more.
Okay, that still trumps whatever.
Setting a higher standard doesn't trump. You got your logic backwards. Setting a higher standard does not trump state law. Ask the attorney.
Madam Chair, I think this is the time where the council discussion, and now we're engaging.
I know that.
All right, listen to me. I've been here a long time, too. When Nick was here, Nick
Banta,
remember the other planner?
Yes.
I had many, many people come to me. They wanted to go to the planning department. They had a complaint. So I took them to the planning department. I met with Nick, and we straightened it out. We never had a problem. All of a sudden, when somebody wanted information, Nick would go to the back and bring out the file and show this and make a decision, right or wrong. We didn't have to have lawyers. All of a sudden, modern technology, or assumed power by employees here, that we need a lawyer.
Right. 3 years ago, I had a problem.
We got to make some money, so we need a lawyer.
I had a problem with the planning department.
Okay.
And we went through about the fourth meeting, and Nick came in, and every commissioner, all 7 out of 7 were against me. He came in 20 seconds and solved the problem. He says, we do this all the time. He solved it right there. They built the wall.
I used to go in too, get information. They went in the back, they gave me the information, and I gave it to my constituents.
Right. Okay? See, there's something you gotta know the right person.
Why what's going on here is embarrassing. Mm-hmm. It is stupid. So let's postpone this thing and give it to the legal department as the rules state now, as the planner would like it, or the council. Let's get rid of it. All right, I'll call the call that I would propose. I made a motion.
This is a motion to postpone,
or
are we
going
to vote on
this?
Once the postponed to the next regular meeting.
I don't know what the problem this guy has. He has the same problem in the planning commission meeting too.
Right.
Everything is going according to the planning and legalized. I make this application month of October. October, there's a both pharmacy and urgent care. They both apply for these locations. And in October, the planning commission already approved the working permit for urgent care construction. The urgent care just already opened. And this is only for the pharmacy. And we also apply at the same time. And as for the special request, we fill out the form. What was the legalized document? They also already been issued on the time zone. And everything that happens, according to the timeline and schedule. I don't know what's the problem he has. And because of that, my business is suffering. So, should I have to wait again another 3 or 4 months for the same thing?
No.
This is the same problem. You can see the video recording in the planning commission. He has the same thing. And this is totally, I don't want to say anything.
I understand what you're saying.
I don't know. He has any problem with the pharmacy, or he has a problem with the planning commission, or what's the problem with it?
Sir, I understand. And we're going to vote on the motion to postpone. No, please. We're done with that. No, I don't want to hear that anymore. We're having a motion about postpone. All right. We have a motion on the floor.
The public hearing is still open.
The public hearing.
Just to help the gentleman off the petitioner, this is the 23rd. We have a meeting on the 30th. That is the committee of the whole. It's 7 days, so we'll fit in. If we have to do whatever we have to do to be legal, we'll bring this individual back on the 30th. Is that all right, Sue?
26. Which is another committee of the whole.
How are you waiting for 4 months? So I don't know how long I have to wait.
1 week.
1 week. Monday.
One more week.
We want to make sure.
sure that we're on the right place for this, you know, attack, the allegation that we're doing something wrong, and we want to make sure that what we say and the proof we do is legally right.
But if it's not correct, is it going to be enough time to publish give enough notice to the public? We're saying 1 week, so we need to give ourselves ample time if, in fact,
the question from the city attorney, Ms. Ward, did you hear that?
Sorry,
the question was if we have to re-notify, we're not closing the public hearing, we're just putting it in abeyance, but until the next meeting, we're postponing.
Should we make the meeting?
She's saying, do we have to re-notice? Well, I thought what we could do is we could look at the situation, report back next meeting, which is the 30th. If we need to, so the next regular is February.
But he's being hurt by this delay. It's beyond a week. He's telling us these are things that happen. Not at the public hearing. I don't think so.
I mean, we still have to make sure that we comply with all the notice requirements.
So is it going forward, or is the fact that we didn't do it like that to make sure that we did it correctly, or are we having to go forward and start the process again, is what I'm saying.
Without looking at the dates of when everything was published and what references there were in each of the notices, it's impossible to say. So that's what I thought we would look at, and sit down with planning, we'll look at the notices, the date they were published, and see whether the notices were properly published. If they were not, then I would say what we should do after we report back this next Monday on the 30th, we could send out the new notices for the February meeting, and we would make sure that they are done properly.
Right, but what this gentleman is saying is that everything all these things that we've noticed are these things is all wrong.
Better to do it legal than have to do it over and over again.
All right, so we'll postpone until Monday.
Until Monday the
30th. We'll report back as well.
All right,
so that's the motion on the floor. Postpone.
Thank you. Yes. Tell me, what are we postponing to?
We're postponing the matter, and we're going to come back on Monday with a review of the issues that have been raised tonight.
So we're leaving the public hearing open.
Correct.
And postponing a decision on the special use? Because I'm not sure.
If the notices are proper, then the public hearing tonight was proper. If the notices were improper, then the public hearing tonight would not be properly notified.
Or was it the Planning Commission public hearing? That's what I'm understanding.
Well, if I said through the chair, if you look at the notice for tonight's meeting, the notice to advertise the public hearing this evening was within the 15 days. It says on the bottom of the notice when it was published, exactly 15 days, I believe if I counted correctly. So the notice today was properly advertised. I think there's a discrepancy between the Planning Commission notices and the City Council notices. I believe the City Council notices were correct. It was the Planning Commission notices that Mr. Mullen is making reference to.
So
if
it's the Planning Commission, do we have to go back? They're only a recommending body. Do we have to go back and make sure everything was compliant with there?
Well, again, in terms of the notice, the notice was actually, it was a longer notice than what the ordinance would have required. So anybody that got the notice, they had more time than, it wasn't that we only gave 2 days notice, and so there wasn't sufficient time.
But if it's beyond, it's supposed to be within a certain hearing.
It's between not less than 5 and not more than 15 days prior notice. So if the ones for tonight were published on the 8th, tonight would be exactly the 15th day.
So what I'm trying to find out is what's happened with the Planning Commission. Does that affect what we're going to do tonight?
But there was also a claim that there were some deficiencies in the notice itself for tonight.
And I understand it's for tonight, and Ms. Banks is saying there was not.
Well, the publishing date is what she's addressing.
Okay.
I thought what I heard is that there were errors in the notice itself in terms of the sections continue the public hearing on February 24th meeting. Even if we find that everything was done properly, it would then go to the February 24th meeting to continue the public hearing.
It's going to hurt the petitioner, and that is not his fault.
I understand, but we have, there are, I mean, we've got to go back and look at the issues.
Do it right, or you don't handle it over again.
I know.
Can we give him a special permission to do, to get started on his work?
Well, no, that would be a special use. That would be a special use. That's what they're asking for. Special use.
Well, why should he be punished for the mistakes of the planning department or somebody?
We're not sure who made this. Let's not accuse anybody, actually. We don't know.
Oh, but it's plain and clear, isn't it?
No. Are we going to vote on this motion?
Yeah.
All right.
Do we need to have a motion to postpone the public hearing and a motion to postpone the special use?
Well, in essence, you're postponing the request that's before you. Because the public hearing was open, it has not been closed, it would be continued at the next regular meeting, which we're assuming is February 24th.
Okay, we can do that.
You can do that. Do that.
Right.
And by then we will know, we will go on through an analysis of when these were published and what was the content of each of the notices to see if there was something improper in the notice.
I just have one suggestion that may help us work our way through this bowl, and that is Mr. Mullen was obviously reading from a prepared document. I'd like to get a copy of that so we address each of his issues so that we don't think we have it all, and then we have to go through it again.
I think that would be helpful.
Yes, I think just as a guideline for what we're taking a look at. Secondly, when this is all over with, dust settles, I think we need to look at the wording in our ordinance so that it's parallel to the state ordinance or state statute or.
We'll look at that.
Mr. Mullen, we do need a copy of what you read to us tonight. If you can provide us with that so that we can look at that in terms of what you said we had done or not done correctly, if you would.
More than happy.
Thank you. All right, so we have a motion on the floor to postpone to which date?
The motion was to postpone to the next regular meeting, made by Councilman Lance and supported by Mr. Steiner.
The next regular meeting? We said 1 week, but we're going to postpone it.
Well, we were going to postpone a report back to you till the 30th, but the actual public hearing would be postponed until February 24th.
Right, so we're postponing.
February 24th.
The motion is to postpone to the 24th.
Why wouldn't it be February 13th? I mean, we have 15 days.
It's February 13th, the COW?
That's a regular meeting.
Well, the next meeting,
yeah.
February 13th, then, is the meeting.
Yeah.
All right. All right, we have a motion on the floor to postpone the public hearing, continue public hearing February 13th. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The motion has carried.
All right. To the legal department.
Is the public hearing still open?
No.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Post
Oh, nothing.
Well, I said,
nothing cost. I'm paying $2,000 every month rent to the landlord. And she said, nothing. I'm paying $2,000 every month rent.
Can he somehow go ahead temporarily?
No, he's asking for a special use, and the procedure is established by the ordinance, and we need to comply with the ordinance. And that's what we want the opportunity to do, to make sure that the notices are done properly, so that there's no question that...
I'm caught in the middle. I'm sorry. I can't do it anymore.
I would like to
review the state statute, which I believe we have followed, and maybe the next course of action is to update the ordinance. Maybe there's old language in the ordinance with regards to noticing requirements. The ordinance says, and the city attorney can correct me, that if there's an error in any one subsection of the ordinance, it doesn't supersede or make the ordinance invalid. So this might just be an old standard that was never updated. So I would like the opportunity to confer with the city attorney and my department to review the procedures with regards to the review of the site plan applications. We're bound by the FOIA request. And to my knowledge, this gentleman has never talked to me or asked any questions. So we're following proper procedures to the best of our knowledge. And I would like an opportunity again after this meeting to review our files and come back and give you a full report. I'll be the first one to admit if we've made a mistake and how to correct it.
That's a reasonable request, Mr. Crowley.
Thank you.
You'll have that opportunity. Thank you.
Ms. Jordan, Madam President, I do not have a concern if this gentleman did request a FOIA request in the clerk's office and the clerk, it didn't get there. You see what I'm saying? If the clerk decided a FOIA request wasn't needed and it was just a question, I think we've got to leave it up to that individual requesting a FOIA request as opposed to the person influencing. That's what I'm concerned about. If there's any influence not to follow through on something that the gentleman had requested.
There was definitely not, I definitely did not influence anything. It was basically a simple yes-no answer with reference to what he was seeking, and all I did was make one telephone call. I didn't feel, he actually was at the counter very upset, saying, I don't understand why I have to do this. I read the request, and I said, well, let me make a phone call for you. He made one phone call. His question was answered versus a FOIA request, which is a five-day response. You know, letters have to be sent. Everything was resolved with one simple phone call. And if my memory serves me correctly, it was with reference to a building question. I don't remember it being a planning. But he seemed very...
He good seemed lighting. Good planning. Good lighting. Got your name on the back.
I guess I have to see. I thought he was there. Oh, no, and we'll be more than happy to. And I'd like to sit down with the city attorney also to make sure all the proper sections are being cited because there are two section numbers between both departments. And then we can resolve this issue. And if Mr. Mullen wants to resubmit his FOIA request, we'll be more than happy to take it.
What I would suggest is because it does seem that there is confusion in terms of whether a FOIA request was submitted. Once it is submitted, it then goes to the department, and there would have been a response. So I would ask that if there is still a desire by Mr. Mullen that he come tomorrow, present the FOIA request, then we would certainly be happy to process it, and he would have the opportunity to look at the records.
And I'd like to have staff be able to get among themselves and then go through this with you to see what happened, because we can't resolve all this here.
Right.
So people like I'm in the memory. And this is a tension in this kind of situation. It's impossible to resolve.
Right. You know, we'd be happy to give the records. We just, if it never got to the department, they couldn't have produced records.
Right.
Madam Chair, I would just like to say that, you know, if someone comes to the counter and asks a question, you know, I think I would expect a clerk to try to help that individual and make a phone call if that would serve that person more rapidly than going with the FOIA, waiting 5 days, involve staff people. If it could be answered
Communications to the other residents. We're talking about the selection process of the police chief. We have not attacked anyone's character. We've only been concerned about the selection process and the educational or qualifications required for such a position. Miss Stephanie English, who I highly respect, I think she's an excellent researcher, she passed out a little packet that had the official job posting, and I wanted to show it to you, the residents. And it basically said under job requirements that a bachelor's degree in a related field or equivalent is required, a master's preferred. Now, I just want to say that if a bachelor's is required, and that was the first part of it, master's preferred, I don't see where we're getting all of this equivalent experience. If you need a bachelor's and it was on there, you have to have it. If it says master's preferred, then you get some extra consideration if you have a master's. Now, I know that there are several candidates, and I just want to tell you some of the educational requirements of some of the candidates. One candidate has an associate's degree, a bachelor's degree, a master's, and a juris doctorate, and all of them have like the FBI Academy and all the other police stuff that's required. Bachelor's in criminal justice, master's in public administration, bachelor's, graduate certificate, criminal justice, master's in business administration, bachelor's, JD, bachelor's, associate degree. Only one candidate does not have a bachelor's degree. So if you are going to say in the job posting a bachelor's is required, how can a person without a bachelor's degree be considered a viable candidate? Not to disrespect any experience here, because I'm sure all of these police chief candidates have some type of experience that they can bring that would benefit the city as a whole and the residents and for their style of policing. We're only looking at what the city of Southfield established in this document that you are calling the City of Southfield Job Opportunity Announcement Extend Closing Date. And that's what you said, and I'll read it again. Bachelor's degree in a related field or equivalent, master's preferred. Now, I'm so glad that Mr. Gerard Mullen came up and talked about what the city does not do right. How many times have myself and other residents came before this council, not to antagonize you, not to disrespect you, but to have our eyes on Southfield like you have asked us to say that maybe the manner in which we're doing something is not correct. What you do when we come before you, you humiliate, you disrespect, you dismiss, you don't pay attention. Some of you do. Mr. Seibert, you pretty much pay attention to everything. Mr. Lance, you pretty much pay attention to everything. And our newly elected youngest council person, I think you're going to set a real standard for this council, Mr. Jeremy Moss. But we have done that. We have attempted to do what you've asked residents to do. And you're just not right. So what you need to do from tonight forward, you need to establish a Southfield standard, write a mission statement that you're going to publish like you do your strategic goals, and then tell the residents what the standard is. I think that's what should be done. And we still are interested in the selection process by which we are going to use to get a chief. I hope it's not going to be, because I've asked this question before and couldn't get it answered, not an attempt to combine police and fire, call it public safety, and pick one director. I hope we're not considering doing that, because I think a gentleman that was on council in the 90s attempted to do that, and it was stated that it couldn't be done. Southfield is too large of a city. So we don't want a public safety department with one public safety director. We want a fire department. We want a police department. We cannot afford to pay for cross-training, which is what would be required if you guys are thinking about doing that. And let's just stop with all the grandstanding, all the bickering. We're not doing things right. And the time that you take to belittle myself and other residents, you could be establishing a standard. gosh, I'm so used to saying, your time is up. And then, you know, just to some of the council people, stop being concerned about the time and listen to the substance. Because sometimes when you guys are talking, some of the stuff that you're using. Thank you.
The next discussion on the transition request is from Stephanie English.
Hi, everyone. My name is Stephanie English. My address is 28735 San Carlos, Southfield 48076. My email address is sdenglish@sbcglobal.net, and my phone number is listed under my full name in the white pages. I'm here on behalf of almost an almost unilateral body of police officers and concerned citizens pertaining to the allegations of embezzlement, fraudulent time reporting, and misuse of city vendors to perform personal work against one of the police chiefs who is now in charge of special investigations for the department. I have been speaking out and acting on behalf of our police officers who have great concerns about these allegations not being properly investigated and this chief remaining as a candidate for the permanent chief of police position. Please note that there is no lobby by the police body organization for any particular chief candidate. There is just an aggressive push to have the this particular chief eliminated as a candidate for the permanent chief of police position. I would like to also relay the fact that the officers, however, are also concerned with a breach of the oath that all of our police officers take, and that this police executive has allegedly executed any time embezzlement and has not been called on the carpet, disciplined, or punished for this alleged these alleged occurrences. The police body would be satisfied with the acting chief simply being eliminated as the permanent chief of police candidate, but they want the law upheld. And they would want a full investigation to be opened or reopened as required by law. I am one of these citizens that is also going to complain about the FOIA issue. I did request the report that supposedly was conducted by Chief Thomas. I received a FOIA letter that is going to be denied, and that is very pertinent to the issues that I have been trying to push forward. The FOIA denial is too lengthy to go into, but it is actually pertinent, you know, to the issue that I've been trying to push forward. Just continuing on, they want the law upheld and they want a full investigation to be opened or reopened as required by law and the proper investigation done. Because no action by the city administration has been done, I have delivered this issue to the FBI team located in Troy, Michigan. Please note that it's not just a potential crime that might have allegedly been done by this police executive, but it is an appearance of intentional or unintentional cover-up or no action being done to conduct a proper investigation by the city administration. Words don't count. Proofs and evidence do count. And we have it. Myself and any of the other police officers that want to come forward with hard evidence. Time embezzlement is a crime. Officers take an oath to uphold any laws, and using power or position to circumvent laws should not be tolerated in any instance. I look at you guys all in the face, and I have to say that these are strong allegations that I make, but I make them eyeball to eyeball with you as a leader body. I have made them directly in this kind of form to the person that these allegations are allegedly against. I stand confident that the information that we have, if anybody asks for it and we have an opportunity to present it openly, is going to stand. I would not be putting my personal reputation on the line like this unless I felt that what the officers have is substantial and viable and credible. The other thing that I find interesting is that with these hard statements that I'm making, that There's nothing or a statement not coming back from this particular acting chief of police that he did not do what he's being accused of. He's the chief of police of the investigation department, so he knows the game of not stating what he didn't do if he really did it, because he might be committing perjury. So instead, it looks like he's hiding behind the wall of city administrators, leaders, and the city attorney, who are bent on protecting him and not giving due process to citizens like myself to be given a legitimate meeting opportunity to formally submit this as a presentation. I thank you very much. Oh, and also, too, if I have a few seconds, this FOIA issue is as smoky as a fire. It is not transparent. You have to jump through hoops for what you claim is a transparent city. Okay, thank you.
Is Mr. Meltzer here? Is Mr. Richard Meltzer? Your time starts. You can start speaking. Your name and address.
Richard Meltzer, 20850 Wink in Southfield. For the benefit of our viewing audience, I want to let our community know that the Michigan Public Service Commission, or the MPSC, announced that they will conduct a formal study of smart meters. For those unfamiliar with smart meters, they are the new computerized meters that our electric utility, DTE, recently installed on our homes and buildings as a replacement for the older mechanical meters we've used for years. The MPSC study is a result of resolutions passed by 9 local governments, including Southfield, expressing concern with the new radio frequency, or RF, emitting computerized smart meters, concerns with issues of health and safety, personal data protection, and network security. Though announcement of the study is good news and represents progress, a number of concerns remain. These include, item, the MPSC did not require DTE to stop deploying smart meters during the six-month study period, nor did they restrict the deployment of any of the other utilities. Item, there is no attempt to include independent experts in the study. This limits expertise, since the MPSC has limited resources, and this constraint does little to ensure objective analysis. Item, there is no effort to establish a current baseline of average RF exposure, which could easily be done with field studies. This is important because some medical and public health researchers state that long-term exposure to increasing levels of RF can have adverse health effects. RF waves have become pervasive and include cell phones and towers, broadcast TV and radio, Wi-Fi, microwaves, and many other sources of commercial telecommunications. By example, cell phones were originally touted as completely safe, but now safety precautions are offered for heavy users. Let's remember that each of the utilities want to add an RF smart meter to our homes. Apartment and condo complexes will have clusters of dozens of these smart meters close to living quarters. Past studies and government standards have only measured these devices operating in isolation. We need to calibrate how much more RF will be added by new smart meters. Item, the MPSC has made no effort to determine how often and of what strength the smart meters broadcast, nor do they set manufacturer requirements to enable smart meters to make that data available to consumers. Item, there are no performance metrics established to determine the degree of success of the smart meter program. Research shows that the majority of smart meter programs in other countries have not provided the business return on investment initially promised. Item, there is also an absence of performance metrics for the approved service DTE claims will result from smart meters. Item, MPSC did not create provisions for an open forum for public debate of the issues as we had requested. Item, and there is still no hint at the MPSC website informing the public that there is a large movement contesting the deployment of smart meters. No mention of 9
Toby, Toby Zoe.
My name is Toby Rhodes, I live at 17001 New Jersey, Southfield, Michigan 48075. My phone number there is 248-569-7189. The reason why I'm here today is to talk about police harassment, police brutality on the part of the Southfield Police with regard to my living in my neighborhood. Since 2009, I've been constantly harassed by the Southfield Police when walking around in my neighborhood. I've been stopped just when I walk to the store, when I walk to the grocery store. And it seems as if I've lived in Southfield since the late 80s, and I've never noticed any problems with the police until after 2008. And I noticed a change in police interactions. Just generally in the neighborhood, I see started seeing a lot more police cars riding up and down the street. I saw, when I go into the store, I see the police, and they look very hostile. For instance, I went to the gas station and saw like one cop reach for his gun just as I was getting a candy bar. So, and that was before I started having all of these police interactions with brutality. So I did notice a change after 2008 with the conduct of the Southfield Police. In 2009, they falsely accused me. Of course, there was no action by the city attorney of Southfield promptly rubber stamped it, didn't look into the matter, didn't look into if there was any evidence. Fortunately, there was one Southfield prosecutor who saw that there was no evidence, so that was resolved. But the fact remained that the Southfield Police charged me without cause. They used the law as a weapon against someone who lives in the residence, has never been accused by anyone, has never hurt anyone or hurt anyone's property in the community, and has been living in the community peacefully and orderly. And yet the Southfield Police chose to target me and to attack me in my own neighborhood just for walking down the street peacefully. Then in 2010, I decided to picket Bank of America. Bank of America has been nothing but a plague on this country and a plague on the city of Southfield. I know they have the air of respectability that they're a bank and that they're supposed to be established, but they're not a Michigan bank. They don't care about the people of Southfield. They don't care about the people of Michigan. All they care about is just protecting their paychecks and their jobs. And I decided to picket Bank of America because I understand that they throw my neighbors out on the street, they deny us credit, they deny us loans, and yet they think they have the permission to come in our community without our permission to continue these kind of activities. So I peacefully protested the Bank of America and the Southfield Police instead of protecting the interests of the community that's going to be here even after Bank of America is gone, they chose to attack me. And the Southfield City Attorney, once again, in the cowardly way that they usually do, rubber stamped what the Southfield Police was. And even though there was no evidence of anything that I had done wrong, and I had not hurt anyone, and I had just exercised my civil rights, Martin Luther King fought for, and other civil rights, Medgar Evers fought for, instead of protecting my rights, the City Attorney just rubber stamped it, which explains the behavior of the Southfield Police. They know that there's never going to be any challenge to their conduct by the City Attorney. They're just going to rubber stamp whatever they do. I had to go through almost a year and a half of trial, and of course I was found not guilty because there was no evidence, but the harm was done, irreparable harm was done. My life was put on hold just because the Southfield Police wanted to lie. They used the law not to protect the community. They used the law to protect Bank of America, Bank of America's interests. It's almost as if they're the Bank of America Police, even though Bank of America is not the ones who've been supporting them all these years. The community residents, the people who live here, the homeowners, the taxpayers. But the Southfield Police didn't give me credit to that. They gave no consideration to that. Instead, they just immediately sided with Bank of America, even though Bank of America is not from Southfield. And so that was in 2010. I had to go through a proceeding that ended middle of 2011. Then I decided once again to take a Bank of America. And the Southfield Police once again attacked me without cause, without reason, without hurting anybody, just because I wanted to peacefully protest and warn my neighbors about the harm and the threat that Bank of America is. And once again, I had to go through a prosecution by the city attorney. It was too cowardly to check the actions of the Southfield Police. Then you go to these cowardly judges, not all of them, two of them. One of them actually came through big time. But those cowardly judges, instead of standing up to the Southfield Police, they rubber stamped it too. And it was all lies, and once again, I was found not guilty. And these are the kind of harassment I have to go through just to inform my community. I didn't do anything to anybody. I'm just trying to tell them about the threat that Bank of America is. But instead of protecting the interests of the community, the Southfield Police attacked the community.
Southfield police are not here to protect us. They are law enforcement. They are here to attack us. They have their special interests that they protect. They protect their paychecks and their budgets and their particular interests, but they don't particularly care about whether or not the homeowner is actually paying.
Mr. Rowland, your time is up.
Oh, thank you.
Next, we have a
Council
item.
An extension
form
of
the Council
for Detroit Economic Club. Madam President.
What?
I move to accept the expense report of the Councilman for Cassidy for the Detroit Economic Club on December 15th.
Support.
Motion by Mr. Moss, supported by Mr. Frazier. All in favor?
Aye.
Let the record indicate that I abstain.
Yes. Motion is carried. Anyone else, Council?
Yes, I have two items that I'd like to bring forth. One, Council, I would like to refer to a council study at a later date exploring all elected officials having vacated the office that they've been elected to, should they choose to seek another office. I'd like that referred to a council study. The other item I want to bring up is I heard some statements made by a few members of the public, and the word embezzlement, false report, no, and having those individuals looking in camera to the residents of the city and the viewing audience that the city of Southfield is involved in a cover up. And as I stated in our prior committee of the whole meeting, there is no cover up here in the city of Southfield as it relates to the selection of the city chief. The city administrator has not brought forth any candidate that this body will be selecting or has been presented. The city administrator has not presented any candidate for us to decide who will be the next chief. And so I want the audience to know, the public to know, that there has not been any individual brought forward. There's not any cover up that the city operates, in my opinion, to the highest level of integrity. And if in fact we may have done something wrong, and we see that could be a possibility with the two items that were brought forth under the public hearing, we will make the correction. But there is not any cover up. And I think there was a recent lengthy article in the Southwest Sun as it related to the selection of the police chief. And when our city administrator brings that person forward, we will move forward at that point. Thank you very much.
Anyone else? No? And none? Madam Mayor?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a couple items. We again had our daddy's daughter, Dan, on the city of Southfield. And if you ever want to look at the leadership of the men in this community, that event is just amazing. It is a sold-out event every year, and it's just something to see the little girls on the arms of their dads. And it says a lot about the Southfield community and how the men and the fathers of this community take their role proudly, and that night, I think the dads smile as much as the little girls going in, or the uncles or the grandfathers who escort their daughters. So Southfield has continued to have this event, and it continues to be a sold-out event, and some little girls are here playing for months to make sure that they are prepared, and dad is prepared for the night. I also want to comment on the Martin Luther King Day walk. It was a fabulous turnout. The young people who were there, the program, our display of all the different talents of young people in the community, and we were all asked why do we continue to have a Martin Luther Day King March, and it's because we'll never forget. And one of the things our youth today, who were born in the United States, with all the freedoms that they have, sometimes I think take for granted that, and the reason why Southfield was with leader in this region on celebrating the rights of all people and how we live together in harmony. So it was just, it's always like turning and looking at the back, looking at the sea of people walking, and in the spirit of reinforcing the dream of all of us being equal and the dream of us fighting for our rights and living together. So again, I'm proud to say that Southfield had this event, and it was just a tremendous community turnout. The other thing I want the community to know, that there was a new Chamber of Commerce that was started in the city of Southfield. We now have a Southfield branch of the Black Chamber of Commerce that's in the city of Southfield. They, I was there for their lodge meeting. And as you know, we have many ethnic groups that form different chambers. We have in the city of Southfield the Chaldean Chamber. I'm very active and involved with the Lebanese and the Arab chambers that are part of our community. So we have added the Black Chamber, and I'm very proud of that group, and they are really looking forward to working with the city and continue to grow our commerce and our economy. I do have one question to the city administrator and to Public Works. On the night that we had the one storm of the year, it's my understanding that we literally had to close the lodge because of the accidents and waiting for the roads to be salted. Can you give me any explanation of why we had such a treacherous situation on the lodge and why we had to wait so long for it to be salted?
Through the chair, in terms of the responsibilities there, Mr. Lebowski.
Lodge is responsible to the state, and Oakland County Road Commission does the maintenance for them. We did go down on Saturday morning and spread salt for them because they had not been able to get to it. We also had some refreezing. Temperatures dropped so quick that we did have a lot of refreezing. Even our roads that we had clear started to refreeze in certain areas.
That seems like... Have we ever had to go down and salt the roads itself before? I mean,
yes.
There wasn't that much snow. So
it was just that it turned so cold. Once we removed the first layer of snow, it was so cold that the traffic that was out there froze that road very quick.
So 2 hours to wait for it to be salted?
We got the call early in the morning on Saturday. That's the first call we got from dispatch. It was about 7 o'clock in the morning.
So have we communicated with the state?
We've already talked to the county locally at the Port of Southwood for us. They were in the middle of a shift change. As you know, the county only works 16 hours. Then their people have to go home. It's mandatory at that time. They had a very skeleton crew out there at that point.
Well, we need to have some dialogue because I understand that everyone's cutting back, and that includes us. But to say that our roads, our major expressway going through our city, have to be shut down for 2 hours to be salted, and I understand there were some conditions, but my goodness, it was the first snow of the year, and this just does not sound like this was properly handled. I'm not satisfied with it. I know that.
We will make contact with the persons responsible, the departments responsible, and the fact that it's been brought up before our public is good, and we will state the case because we got our job done to an excellent standard, and I'm glad we did what we did to alleviate the situation. But frankly, I don't know any crew that has percentages reductions that we've had, and we don't use excuses here. But we get the job done. We find a way to do it. And that's unacceptable. I totally agree with you, Madam Mayor.
And Jim Charette, our city administrator, to our public work. You know, we have excellent public work here in our city. But there needs to be, if everyone's cutting back, we have to make sure we're all on the same page because it's our residents, it's our roads in Southfield that we should have a clear
9th this year. There was a discussion with council relative to an adoption of an ordinance that would allow the city to seek reimbursement for medical services that were performed during the period that a person is in the custody of the city of Southfield. Council discussed the matter. There was a consensus reached that council was in agreement with that type of an ordinance. And so this evening, you will see a proposed ordinance that would accomplish that. In essence, it would allow the city to seek reimbursement for medical services and medical transport that were provided to people during the point or the period that person is in the custody of the city. And that is the ordinance that would accomplish that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
fantastic part of Mr. Cyber, Madam Clerk, just listening all of these revisions that were.
That's correct.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion has carried. Mr. Crowe, do you have a bus chair?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm requesting with the city attorney to extend the moratorium on wind turbines for an additional 90 days. At your council meeting on October 24, 2011, this honorable body granted a 120-day extension of the moratorium on wind turbines to February 1, 2012, to allow for further study and to give the Planning Commission ample time to hold study meetings and conduct a public hearing prior to making a recommendation to City Council. Since October 24th, staff has done considerable study on this issue, has completed a draft of the proposed sustainable energy ordinance, has met with the city attorney's office, has conducted several meetings with the Planning Commission, and it is currently being reviewed by Oakland County for additional input. We believe that we plan to schedule this item for a public hearing with the Planning Commission in February and bring it back to the council in March. Therefore, that is beyond the current moratorium, and we are requesting an additional 90 days to April 30th, 2012, to give the Planning Commission additional time to hold the study sessions, the required public hearing, and give us the time to have this as the work items with the council before your ultimate public hearing and adoption. We've expanded the scope of the wind turbines to also include solar, and we're looking at other sustainable energy items. So the wind turbine would be part and parcel to an overall sustainable energy ordinance.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Mr. Cyber, supported by Mr. Frazier.